Thank you for coming tonight. I'm Chris Barnes, and I'm Professor of Business Management here at Lakeland. And I want to thank you for coming to the Dworkin and Bernstein Management Lecture Series. The lecture series is made possible by a generous contribution of the law firm of Dworkin and Bernstein. And I think you're really going to enjoy our presentation this evening. And we are going to have Ronn Richard of the Cleveland Foundation. Over the past 29 years, Ronn has had a variety of senior management positions in government, the private sector, and nonprofit sector. He's going to go into detail about his career and what he has done, but I'm going to give you just a tiny sneak peek. He's been with the CIA. He's been an executive at Panasonic without ever having taken a business class, which I really don't want you to know, but we'll share that later. He has also been with the US Foreign Service. He's lived in Japan, New York City, Washington, DC, San Francisco, and a myriad of other cities, and I'm gonna leave it to him to explain what brought him to Cleveland and the Cleveland Foundation. The Cleveland Foundation, it's celebrating its centennial this year. It was founded in 1914 by Frederick Harris Goff, who was a lawyer and a banker. I'm going to show a quick 30-second video that shows the mission of the Cleveland Foundation.
We are the Cleveland Foundation, Greater Cleveland's largest grant-making organization, giving about $85 million each year to reform education, create jobs, revitalize neighborhoods, nurture youth, support arts, and so much more. You can give to your favorite causes through the Cleveland Foundation, and your gift can last and keep on giving forever. If giving back to Cleveland is important to you, why not partner with us, the Cleveland Foundation? If you want to be remembered, do something memorable.
So I think in 30 seconds, it really gives a nice look at what the Cleveland Foundation does, and Ronn will go into more detail. But truly, the mission is to enhance the lives of all residents of Greater Cleveland now and for generations to come, which is a fantastic mission. They work with donors to build community endowment, address needs through grant making, and provide leadership on key community issues. The foundation has assets over $2 billion, and the last records, they issued over 3,000 grants to not-for-profit organizations in 2012. And those grants to those organizations support Greater Cleveland projects and programs to benefit citizens, meet community needs, and test new ideas. Mr. Richard holds a master's degree in international relations from the Johns Hopkins University School of Advanced International Studies. He has a bachelor's degree in history from Washington University in St. Louis, and he also has honorary doctorates from both Notre Dame College and Baldwin-Wallace University. He's a recipient of the African American President's Council Champion Award for his work on inclusive economic development, and in 2007, he received Wheaton College's Otis Award for Social Justice that has also prior been won by Senator Edward Kennedy. Ronn is married to Bess, who is an artist, and they live in Cleveland Heights. As he told me, they have two children and a dog. And so please, if you would all help me in welcoming Ronn Richard, President and CEO of the Cleveland Foundation.
Great, good evening. Wonderful to see you. I'll spend a little time at the podium and maybe a little time in the chair, so do feel free to move up even to the front row so we can make it a little more of an intimate conversation if you're not too shy. So I'll give a little quick commercial for the Cleveland Foundation just so you all know what it is. We're the oldest community foundation in the world. There are about 1,400 of them now. 700 in the U.S., 700 overseas. We gave away in that year when we gave 3,000 grants, $92 million just in Greater Cleveland. That can extend out to this college where we've given lots of grants. The difference between a community foundation and, say, the Ford Foundation is community foundations raise all their money locally and give it all away locally, whereas the Ford Foundation can give their money in Africa, Asia, Latin America, et cetera. So we're really proud of the fact that we're all about supporting the greater Cleveland region. And we give in every category, kind of soup to nuts, the arts, social services, economic development, environmental issues, social services, and so on and so forth. So we're kind of limited just by our imagination. So just so you know what the Cleveland Foundation is, I'm proud to be at the helm, especially in our centennial year. So I will tell you the assignment. I've been out of school for a long time, but I do remember you're supposed to do what the instructions said. So my instructions were to talk about how did I get to where I am, what were my personal values that made me successful, and if someone were to start a career at the foundation or anywhere else that I have worked, what would I expect of them to consider promoting them into the executive ranks? So, how did I get to where I am? By the time I'm done, you'll know that it was incredible planning from an early age. I really had my act together, sort of, not really. So I have had a pretty strange career. Starting my first job really out of grad school was as director of the National Public Affairs Program at the Japan Society in New York. After that, I entered the Foreign Service or the U.S. Diplomatic Corps. Then I went to Panasonic in several jobs. My first job there for several years was to support the board of directors back in Japan, working directly for the board. Then I was made head of R&D for North America. We had about 8 labs all over the U.S. and Canada. And then head of most of the major headquarters functions at Panasonic. So I was sitting in the office next to the chairman and CEO, and I was in charge of corporate planning, public affairs, government relations, intellectual property rights, patents, copyrights, et cetera, engineering, environmental issues, and still in charge of R&D. And then I was head of one of their largest sales companies, so in charge, of course, of market research, marketing, sales, advertising, warehousing, mergers. And then I went to serve as managing director of the CIA's venture capital firm, In-Q-Tel. And from there to my present job as president of the Cleveland Foundation. So as you can see, it was the typical foundation president path. I'm teasing. Most foundation presidents come out of academia or maybe social work. In addition to those things, two other things that I've done simultaneously that I'm really proud of is that I was the I served for the last 10 years as a member of the board of directors and now as the lead director for Emergent BioSolutions, which is an important biopharma company. It's the only company in the world that makes the vaccine for anthrax in case of a terrorist attack. And I was the founding chairman of the board of the International Biomedical Research Alliance, which is a really important alliance between the National Institutes of Health, Oxford University, and Cambridge University. And I've been on dozens of nonprofit and university boards. I was very proud to have been on the board of Spelman College for many, many years, and on the Georgetown University School of Foreign Service Landegger Program Board. So how did I get there? I should pause just to say that I really don't like talking about myself. I love talking about the Cleveland Foundation, but the assignment is to talk about my own life journey, so I'll try to stick to that. So how did I get there? I guess I should talk just briefly about my upbringing and some childhood experiences that really formed my values in my early years and as an adolescent. And of course, as you'll see, luck had a lot to do with getting to where I am. So anyway, I'll walk you through these key experiences. So I wasn't born with a silver spoon in my mouth. My parents met in an orphanage in Cleveland called Belfair, which is still there, and which our daughter happens to live at now because she's autistic, and it's now they have a residence for autistic adults, so kind of life went full circle for us. But my parents married at 18. They graduated from high school, had to leave the orphanage, so my dad decided to join the Marine Corps, and told my mother when he got enough money to send her a one-way bus ticket. And after he finished his little vacation at Paris Island for basic training, he would send her a one-way bus ticket, which he did. He was stationed at Arlington Hall, which is Marine Corps headquarters in the DC area. And so that's where the one-way bus ticket went to. And so my parents had five kids by the time they were, can't quite remember, but 25 or something like that. And my dad was working three jobs when I was born. And it was an interesting early life experience. My father had had some very difficult times before he went to Belfair. He actually, for many years, was literally homeless, living without parents by himself. Under the boardwalk in Miami, on the streets, eating from trash cans. So my father really inculcated in us, I don't know quite how to describe it, but respect for everyone. And I never saw my father walk by a panhandler without giving him a $10 bill or a $20 bill. He really never forgot where he came from. And I think his kids have never forgot where he came from either. When I was growing up in the DC suburb of Potomac, Maryland, which is a wealthy suburb, sort of like Orange or Gates Mills or Solon here, or Mentor, there were two elementary schools. And one of them had very, very impoverished kids. Even though Montgomery County, Maryland, is one of the richest counties in the country, they had some real pockets of extreme poverty, the kind that you would see in Alabama or Mississippi. There was an area called Toby Town, which was all African American, people living in buses with no wheels on them, tar paper shacks, you know, cars, no running water, no toilets, they cooked outside, in a barrel with, wood and whatnot, and they were really poor, washed their clothes in the Potomac River. Not far at all from, the White House, maybe a 25-minute trip into the White House. And then there was an area that the kids called themselves white trash, really poor kids. There were a lot of horse farms out there, and so they were, people who worked in the stables and the things like that, sharecroppers. And there were two schools, and I should have gone, of course, to the, because by this time, my father had had some success, and we were solidly middle class, maybe even upper middle class. And I should have gone to Potomac Elementary School, because that's where the wealthy white middle class or really wealthy kids went. But my parents decided that they were not happy with Potomac Elementary School for doing everything possible to keep poor African American kids out of the school. And so they decided, as their sort of social protest, to send me and my sibs to Travilla Elementary School, which really was the really low class school. I went there. I loved it. The kids were wonderful to me. I had a lot of friends there. I played in Toby Town. I had sleepovers in people's homes that didn't seem strange to me then, but looking back on it now, they were trailers or very impoverished homes. Everything was great until I went to seventh grade. At seventh grade, we all got dumped into Herbert Hoover Junior High School, which was really the mostly white, almost all white, very middle class school. And at Travilla, I was top of my class. I thought I was really smart. I was really good. My parents read to me a lot when I was a kid, and but when I was dumped into seventh grade, I suddenly realized that I was way, way, way behind in math in particular. And I had always thought I was so great in math. It closed a lot of doors to me, because already in seventh grade, I realized that I liked math. I thought I was good in math. I thought I might be a doctor, but it was sort of made clear to me by my teachers, many of whom knew that I'd gone to Travilla and weren't so keen on having a kid from Travilla in their class, I probably should rule out careers in math and science. I wasn't thinking so much about careers in seventh grade, but you get pigeonholed, and it was clear to me that late start or that disadvantaged early education really was going to plague me for the rest of my schooling. My parents hadn't gone to college. They really didn't know that they should be monitoring my, you know, schooling and all that sort of thing. I saw my dad working really hard. I saw my mother, who loved to read and loved to learn and had always wanted to go to college. And it was her real dream to go to college, but never had the chance with five kids starting at 18. And but she did go to college. The year I started college, she started taking a few courses. And the year I started graduate school, she finished college and went to, got her master's in international relations. So I had a mother that really taught me a love of learning. And she really is quite an intellectual. She was teaching at the premier high school in Montgomery County, teaching, you know, history of the Italian Renaissance, Chinese history, Russian history, Japanese history. She really knew her history. Early on, I, as I said, really kind of wanted to be a doctor, but then in high school, I started doing a lot of volunteer work. I really wanted to help people, and I volunteered in the Children's Cancer Ward at the National Institutes of Health. And I also became a volunteer fireman. I liked to be in the ambulance, and once again thought, well, you know, maybe I could go into medicine because I really, really would love to be a doctor. But I took my SATs and got a 400 in math and a 520 in verbal. So it was pretty clear to me that I wasn't going to go be a pre-med. Somehow I got into Washington University in St. Louis. I had very good grades, and I had a ton of extracurricular activities and great letters of reference. And you know, I had written a letter saying that I'm not good at taking tests. I was so nervous because my early childhood experiences and feeling so inferior when I went into junior high school and was so looked down upon by, you know, the teachers and other kids that, you know, I was, I spent half the test, I think, you know, shaking before I opened the book, so I had bad SAT scores. But anyway, I went to college very fearful that I was going to flunk out. And fortunately, I had a wonderful history professor my first semester, David Koenig at WashU, who calmed me down and mentored me, and he's a really dear friend to this day. Came and visited us a couple years ago and took him to a baseball game here. I majored in history, American history, in college. And then I spent my last year of college in Japan, which happened very much by chance. I had decided in the last semester of my junior year that I wanted to take an Oriental survey course. I had had a Japanese girlfriend at college who convinced me that I should take a course in Oriental cultures, which I did. She dumped me soon thereafter, but I enjoyed the course, learned a lot about Asia. And I was always taking extra classes at WashU to try to get through early. You know, was always worried about, you know, paying the bill. And so I always got some big-hearted teacher to give me an incomplete. So I was always the last person there every year, you know, finishing up my incomplete or two incompletes, and then would go home for the summer. So it was the end of my junior year, and I was in the library at WashU all by myself, totally miserable. You know, it's so miserable when everyone's left campus. You're like the only one left in your dorm. You're the only person in the library, and you're thinking, you know, why didn't I work harder and get this done before, you know, summer? And all of a sudden, I heard this teacher who taught, one of the teachers that team taught this Oriental cultures course, say, oh, great, I found a warm body. And then I looked up and he said, here's the deal. Every year we send a kid to Japan on a scholarship, and they send a Japanese kid here. But the kid who was supposed to go to Japan starting in a month or two decided he couldn't leave his girlfriend. So I need a warm body on a plane to Japan. And it's free. And, you know, and I said, so I'll graduate on time, even if I do my last year in Japan. Oh, absolutely. You know, you've got your credits. And I had been much more fascinated with Latin America and had been studying Spanish. I didn't speak a word of Japanese. And he said, but you got to tell me, like, now. So I said, okay, I'll go to Japan. I don't speak a word of language, but why not, you know? So I called my mom and said, guess where I'm going next year? Japan. And she was like, what? So anyway, I went to Japan, had a wonderful experience, lived with a Japanese family that didn't speak English, learned a lot of Japanese. I learned a lot about Japanese culture, religions, politics, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. And so then I wanted to go to graduate school. But, you know, they didn't have the internet in those days. I couldn't figure out how to job hunt or apply to graduate school from Japan. It just wasn't possible in those days. And so I thought, well, I'll have to come home and, you know, work for a year and then apply for grad schools. So I came home from Japan, you know, really excited. I had a degree from Washington University, a pretty good school. And I just couldn't find any job because I didn't know how to network. I didn't have a network. I didn't have parents who could tell me how to network. And so the only job I could get was a job at the DC Superior Court as a clerk typist. And you didn't even have to have a high school degree to get this job. You just had to type 40 words per minute. So I got this job, and I was totally miserable. Every day, I was completely miserable. I was working with all these people who hadn't gone to college, pretty rednecky. And you know, it was just a terrible existence. And I was living with my mother, you know, who I love dearly. But, you know, I had graduated from college, and I'm living with my mother, and I'm a clerk typist. And so I decided after I'd save all my money, and of course I did apply to graduate school, and I decided that I couldn't stand it anymore, so I took all the money I had and I thought I'd go camping across country, so I got in my little car, Datsun B210, which is about the size of an MG, you know, went cross country for a few months, saw all the national parks, and then I had enough money to buy a Eurail pass and a, you know, ticket to London. And I spent 2 months sleeping on park benches and in alleys and on the beach. And, you know, one night I was in Portugal and I slept on the beach. And when I woke up, there were 30 of the mangiest dogs you've ever seen, all sleeping around me, huddled up, you know. It was, I wasn't at the Ritz. And so that was a good experience. And I came home and I found out that, you know, I called my mom a couple times, collect, and, you know, she'd say, no, we haven't heard yet from grad schools. And then she said, well, you got on the waiting list, you know, where you really wanted to go, the Johns Hopkins School of Advanced International Studies. So, you know, it was the day that school was supposed to start. I called a few times. They said, sorry, you didn't get in off the waiting list. So I decided I'd just show up on the first day and say, come on, I'm here. You should take me, you know. So they did. And then I got into Georgetown School of Foreign Service. I decided, even after Johns Hopkins had let me in, that I should go there instead because they had a better campus, a real campus. SAIS was a fabulous school, better school, but it's in kind of an office building. So I went to Georgetown for a year, but they didn't have any Japanese language program there that was any good. So then I went back to SAIS and said, remember you let me in, you know, and I decided to go to Georgetown. You know, I'm back, take me, you know. So I transferred to Johns Hopkins, got my master's there. So true to form, I was the last person writing my papers because I got some incompletes, you know. And so now everyone had gotten a job and graduated, and I finally finished up and had no idea what I was going to do after graduate school with my master's because I had no network and had no clue how to network. So I went into my wonderful professor, Nathaniel Thayer, who was probably the most famous Japanese politics professor in the United States. And I said, Dr. Thayer, I don't have any job lined up. I took the foreign service exam and I passed it, which is a very hard exam to pass. But they had sent me a letter saying that, congratulations, you passed the exam, but for diversity's sake, we're not taking white males this year. So I knew that I had to wait a year and take it again. And really disappointed because I really wanted to be in the Foreign Service. So I said to Nat there, you know, now what do I do? You know, wait tables for a year or what? And he said, no, just sit down. And he flipped through his Rolodex, dials a number, says, David, hey, it's Nat. And, hey, listen, I've got a great guy here, a young student, just graduated, going into the Foreign Service, but he has to wait a year. And he needs a job. You got anything for him? And he's, okay, where is it? Okay, where did he start? Monday? Okay, great. He hangs up the phone and he goes, okay, I just talked to David Rockefeller. You're gonna be head of the Public Affairs National Program Service at the Japan Society in New York. It's a very prestigious organization right next to the United Nations. And you can hang your hat there until you pass the Foreign Service exam and, you know, they do your security clearance, which could take a year. So, you know, I packed everything I owned in my little car and drove up to New York and found an apartment that I could touch both walls of the apartment. And, you know, I went out and bought a mattress without the box spring and I put it on the floor and I had a box with all my clothes in a box and not a piece of furniture. And it was one of the most fun years of my life. As I paid back my student loans. But anyway, I did then get into the Foreign Service 2 years later than I wanted to, because 2 years in a row I had been told, you know, we're not taking white males at this time. It was when Jimmy Carter was president, which turned out to be a great thing. So one of the lessons is, you know, great things come out of bad things, because my wife met me, and I met her on our first day in Foreign Service orientation class. I would not have met her if I'd gotten in the first year. So you never know. We were in the Foreign Service. We met there. We're engaged very, very shortly thereafter and got married. And our first assignment was to Japan. So we did our first tour in Japan. Where I was an economics officer. And then after that, we were transferred to San Francisco, where I was, again, an economics officer in charge of U.S.-Asian trade and economic flows and covering Silicon Valley and looking at a number of, you know, high-tech kind of issues for the State Department. And so during my years in the State Department, when we were in Japan, I went to a diplomatic party, and I happened to meet this really wonderful, sweet, older Japanese man, Hiroyuki Mizuno, who was the number two at Panasonic, executive vice president, in charge of all R&D and engineering worldwide for the 13th largest company in the world, a company that was bigger than IBM at the time, 300,000 employees. And we really hit it off. And he asked me what I thought of his company. And the formal name of the company then was Matsushita Electric, but the brand name was Panasonic Techniques Quasar. And I said, you know, of course I love your company. It's a wonderful company. And I think it'll be great when you're, you know, an international company. And he looked at me very funny and said, you know, we're in 120 countries. And I said, yes, but I'm sure that the president of Panasonic Brazil and Panasonic France and Panasonic USA and Panasonic Thailand are all Japanese. You'll be an international company when a Brazilian is the head of Panasonic Brazil and so on and so forth. So we kept in touch, and he did something that had never been done in our tour in Japan. He asked me to come to dinner with my wife and his wife. Japanese men always, maybe it's changed now, I don't know, but in those days, you know, you never went out with your wives, you always just went out with men. So I was happy, because I hated leaving my wife home all the time when I had to go out for business dinners. And I think we all hit it off really well. Then we were assigned to San Francisco, and suddenly I got a call one day that he was coming through San Francisco on a business trip, and wanted to get together with us for dinner. So we did that. And towards the end of the dinner, as my wife will recall, he said to me, "I was wondering, why don't you quit the Foreign Service and come work for me?" And I was just stunned. And I said, "Doing what?" And he said, "Oh, I don't know, but I just think you should be a Matsushita man, you know?" So I said, "Okay." And my wife and I were driving home over the Oakland Bay Bridge, and I said, "God, I didn't even ask him what the pay is going to be. I hope it's not a decrease from the Foreign Service." And fortunately, it was quite a sizable increase, because Japanese senior executives had no idea how poorly paid U.S. diplomats were. So for the first several years, I flew all over the world with him, helping him kind of internationalize the company and sort of teaching the board of directors how to be a more international company, working really out of a bedroom in my not-so-huge house in San Francisco, but really was on the road a tremendous amount of time. And then after a couple years, he said, "You know, we'd like to make you head of R&D for North America." And I said, "I was a history major, you know. I have a degree in history and a master's in international relations. I don't know anything about technology, you know." And I was thinking, and I got a 400 on my math SAT. He said, "You know, Ronson, North American R&D's been around for 20 years for Panasonic. And there isn't a single product that says Panasonic on it that got any of its technology from these 8 R&D labs. They need a diplomat. R&D isn't talking to manufacturing or marketing or sales. They're a completely isolated ivory tower. And they just need someone to connect them, and I'm sure you can do it." So I said, "Okay." So we moved to Princeton, New Jersey. And all of a sudden, I have, you know, 8 R&D labs in San Diego and Chicago and Boston. So I have the, you know, the medical R&D lab in Boston. I've got the speech synthesis and recognition lab in San Diego, and the computer science lab in Princeton, and the process engineering lab for factories in Chicago. And I'm going all over the place trying to connect these people to the company. And of course, I've got all these super brilliant Stanford and Princeton grads with, you know, ponytails, I mean the guys, and rings through their nose and ears, and who, like, their biggest complaint to me when I first got there was, "You know, we hate this 9-to-5 policy in the company. You know, we're like engineers, man. You know, if we get on a roll, we want to work till 4 a.m. and sleep till noon." And so I said, "I don't care what time you come to work, as long as you get the job done." And so I was very popular all of a sudden. Of course, I broke all the rules. You know, I didn't ask HR for permission, because I reported directly to Japan, which was 3,000 miles away. I did not report to or work for Panasonic USA, which was 60 miles away in Secaucus near Manhattan. So nobody in Japan knew. In fact, all of a sudden, you know, night is day and day is night. All of a sudden, during the day, they were getting all these faxes from guys at, you know, 3 a.m, because they didn't know that I didn't care if they came into work at 1 p.m. We started to really have some great successes in R&D. And I also was asked to do a major stealth project for the company, which was to go find and buy flat panel display technology, because Panasonic's display technology was very weak compared to the competitors. And that's a whole long, incredibly interesting story for another day. But I successfully bought a company that became the flat panel TVs that say Panasonic. So if you go to Best Buy tonight and you see the flat panel Panasonic TVs, I sort of feel like I'm the father of that those babies. So, and I was head of the DVD business for North America too, getting the standards set, and that was a wonderful thing. So after about 3 years in Princeton, We were invited to go to the chairman's Christmas party up in Manhattan. Really fancy, you know, Christmas party, as you can expect, like big companies like AT&T and IBM would have. So it just so happened that my wife, Bess, sitting right there, was pregnant, very pregnant, with our second child, probably a couple weeks before delivery. It was a winter day, night. It was very icy. She couldn't walk very fast. I didn't want her to walk very fast. So we got to the chairman's Christmas party, chairman and CEO for North America, late. Now, the chairman and CEO for North America was one tough, nasty guy. Everybody was afraid of him. And so when we got there late, the only seat left for me was directly next to the chairman and CEO. And so, and he, his social skills were, you know, a little unusual. He really could sit next to you for an hour and not say a word to you, which becomes very uncomfortable after like 5 minutes and more uncomfortable every passing 10-minute increment. So he didn't say anything to me for about 10, 15 minutes. And in Japanese society, you wait for this superior, senior person to talk to you. So finally, you know, he said something briefly. And it gave me a chance to speak to him in Japanese, which really surprised him. And he said, how do you speak Japanese? And I said back in Japanese, well, I went to college in Japan. And he said, where? And I told him, and you know, what did you study? And I said, I majored in Japanese history. And then I said, Bakumatsu Jidai, which is a very esoteric period in Japanese history. And it turns out Mr. Nakamura loved Japanese history, was a real scholar in Japanese history. So we got into a really animated conversation, and I could see people all over the room looking like, he's talking to somebody, you know? Like, so the next, that was like a Saturday night, and then the next Monday, I got a call from him, and he said, Ronn, son, I'd like you to come up and occupy the office next to me, the chairman and CEO for North America, and come work for me. And I said, what would you like me to do? And he said, oh, I don't know. I'll figure it out later. Just come work for me. So I said, well, I'd be honored, Nakamura-san, but I work directly for the board in Japan. So with your permission, I'd like to fly there and ask them face to face if I may make this switch and bow, thank them in person if they say yes. And he said, oh, of course, I should have thought of that, you know. Yes, I'll send a letter, you know, to Dr. Mizuno, but then you can go, you know. So I went there, they gave me permission, and I showed up for work and said, okay, you know, what's my job? And he said, yeah, I think I'll put you in charge of corporate planning. In a Japanese company, corporate planning is a really important job. It's like being chief of staff in the White House. I mean, it is a really strategic, important job. And I said, oh, you know, I'm very honored, you know, thank you very much. And he said, and while I'm at it, and you can be in charge of public affairs, which is a big department. I said, okay, hai, wakarimashita. And government affairs, and intellectual property rights, and environmental issues, and a few more things that I've long since forgotten. So now I'm sort of, you know, in charge of almost every department except legal and HR. It was a wonderful experience. I loved it. I learned a lot. And after a few years, he said, called me in and said, Ronn, son, I think you should be head of a sales company. Our sales companies were big, you know, they had, you know, like $1 billion worth of sales. You know, we had 7 sales companies, I think, at the time. And I said, Nakamura-san, I've never sold anything in my whole life, you know. And he said, you can figure it out. So I should tell you, you know, when I first showed up to be head of R&D with no degree in engineering, with all these PhDs working for me, you can imagine how, you know, skeptical people were, right? But I think I won him over after a while. And so now I go to a sales company, and you could just hear them groaning, like, who is this guy? He came out of nowhere. He was like down in Princeton where none of us ever went because it was like, who knows what they did down there. And he comes in, he's in the office next to the chairman and CEO and in charge of all these, and now he's going to be head of, you know, people work 30 years to get to be president of a sales company. So I come into the sales company, and we had like 90 products under us. We had the Panasonic wet dry smooth operator shavers that you could use in the shower, and massage lounge chairs and massagers, and we made all the OEM vacuums for Sears. If you go to Sears and you buy a vacuum that says Kenmore, it's made by my division. So we had all these products. And the very first day, I walked by a room, and I saw 12 guys in there. So I would, you know, see all these people in these conference rooms, and I'd open the door and say, hi, I'm your new president, what you doing? And they said, we're figuring out the, you know, the features for, you know, the new line of women's shavers. And I said, what kind of features? You know, what color it should be, what's form factor, what size it should be, you know, things like that. And so I said, well, how have our women's shaver sales been over the last, how long have we been in the business? You know, 10 years. How long have the sales, how long have we had the sales? How have they been? And well, not really good, you know, pretty bad. But the men's shavers, they're doing pretty good, you know. So I said, well, I kind of noticed that there's like no women in this room. And you're talking about the features for women's shavers, so like, maybe it would be cool to let you guys figure out the color and the features, you know, and then we'll find 12 women, put them in another room, and let them come up with the colors and features, and we'll see if they're the same, you know. So of course the men, of course, to a man, they had to be pink, right? Not one of the 12 women wanted a pink shaver. Right? So they were powder blue, and our sales rocketed, you know. So, it, you know, sometimes it's a great advantage not knowing anything about anything. I've proved that time and time again.
Can we open for questions in about 5 minutes?
5 minutes, sure. I'll finish real soon. So then I was asked to come back to headquarters to start a new division called Panasonic Strategic Ventures to do major joint ventures with all these fast-moving Silicon Valley startups. So I was the guy very involved for Panasonic in a huge joint venture with BMG Music, Universal Music, AT&T, and if I had a few hours, I could tell you the culture wars between a conservative Japanese company and, you know, the Hollywood studio people who had like totally different morals and ethics than we had. So then one day I was in my office and George Tenet, an old pal of mine, called. He was head of the CIA and said, you know, hey, I need you to come work for me at the CIA as managing director of our new venture capital firm. We started one. It could use some adult supervision. I'd really appreciate it if you'd come. And, you know, it sounded like a good idea at the time. So I went to my boss and asked if I could have a leave of absence. My country needed me. He said, sure, Japanese understand love of country, patriotism. So I went there, and shortly after 9/11 occurred, it was fascinating to be at the CIA during 9/11. Scary, fascinating, unbelievably hard time, unbelievable work hours and whatnot after 9/11, as you could imagine. So then I was thinking, of course, to finish my leave of absence and go back to Panasonic. But one night, it was my birthday, and my wife and I went out with a friend and his wife. He was the president of one of the big four headhunting firms that only do really top executive searches. And he asked me what I wanted to do when I retired. And I said, are you kidding? I'm 46. I'm not thinking about retiring. And he said, man, you've got to plan it, you know? You've got to learn to golf now. You can't retire at 65 and learn to golf or sail. And I said, well, you know, what I really want to do when I retire is not really retire, but just retire from having to make money and go, you know, work at the Red Cross or some nonprofit, you know, give back. And he looked at me and said, well, if that's what you want to do, why aren't you doing that now as your career? And I said, gee, I really never thought of that. So he said, you know, you need to call Sally Sterling. She used to work for me. She's now at Spencer Stuart. She does all of the top, you know, presidents of foundations and nonprofit searches. And, you know, you really should talk to her. Make a long story short, I called Sally. She had no interest in wasting time with me because headhunters, you know, they work for the companies, not for the person looking for a job. So she said, you know, well, it's great that you're a friend of Mike's. Why don't you come down and I'll meet you in the lobby and you can just hand me your resume and then I'll know what your face looks like and I'll read your resume and if something comes up, I'll call you, you know. So I said to my wife, you know, this is ridiculous. I'm not wasting my time going down there. She's blowing me off, obviously. She's not interested. And what nonprofit's going to hire some dude from the CIA anyway? So I went down there. Long story short, I saw her. I knew I had like 30 seconds for an elevator pitch. So I made a quick elevator pitch. I said, you know, I know you're just doing this as a favor to Mike, and I know you're not interested, but I actually think I have some skills that would benefit a nonprofit organization, you know, and I rattled a bunch of stuff off. And she said, you know, maybe I could carve out a couple minutes, you know, come on back in my office, you know. And 2 hours later, I left, and she called me a few days later and said, can you go to Cleveland tomorrow? We're finishing the search for the president of the Cleveland Foundation. It's one of the most prestigious foundations in the country, in the world. They're down to four. I persuaded them to make it five, although the head of the search committee, David Goldberg, who later became my board chair, said, are you nuts? Look at his resume. Are you crazy? And she said, just trust me, just trust me. And he said, fine, but I'm going to make really short work of this guy. So I said to my wife, why am I even going, you know? Because she shared with me, he's going to make short work of you. But Beth said, oh, come on, you know, you never know. So I came and somehow I got the job. To summarize, you can see that my career has benefited from incredibly successful planning at an early age. So I guess really the message is pretty similar to what Chuck Fowler said, my dear friend Chuck Fowler when he was here, which is it's really all about keeping your eyes open for opportunities that come by that I think a lot of people would be too afraid to jump at, to take. And just wonderful things can happen. I think if you get a good education, then what you really are learning at Lakeland College is how to learn, how to be thrown into any pool and learn how to swim. I taught myself accounting, finance, you know, computer science, engineering, all the things that I needed to know, philanthropy. I just figured out, you know, how to find a book, how to find someone who's an expert, how to persuade them to, you know, spend time with you, teach you, mentor you, and that's my career. So I was asked to, and I'll try to finish quickly because I really do want to hear your questions. I was asked to talk about, you know, what are the values that I had, and then the final question after that was going to be, you know, when I look at the people who work for me, what are the values I look for? So I'll sort of combine those two to save time, you know. As I said, I think a love of learning and intellectual curiosity are incredibly important, but I really do think character is destiny, and I think that what I look for more than anything else is honesty, real honesty. That means first being honest with yourself, being willing to admit mistakes. I once said to my boss in the Foreign Service, you know, how did this screw up? You know, and I said, I made a mistake, you know. And he said, my God, I think you're the first person who's ever said that to me, you know. Fine, you know, you made a mistake. So I think, you know, honesty, integrity, knowing how to manage up and how to manage down. I have seen so many people that were great at managing up, but not at managing down. And the workforce of today, you know, even with factory workers, but in any workforce, especially in a workforce with highly educated people, you have to treat people with respect and understanding and kindness, and you have to know how to motivate them. It's not the old days where you made people, you know, fearful for losing their job. You wouldn't want to work in a company like that. It probably wouldn't be successful. So learning how to manage up and manage down. I hate it when I see an employee that's always kind to me and then I hear that they're being nasty to, you know, the admins and people below them. I think that's just a terrible thing. And those people don't succeed in organizations I've headed up. I think that, this is the one that's maybe a little controversial, but I'll be blunt. What I look for more than anything else is loyalty. And I kind of hate to use the word loyalty, because for people of my age, it conjures up the McCarthy era, when people were questioning Americans' patriotism and loyalty, or, you know, the Watergate situation where people were, you know, so loyal to President Nixon, Haldeman, and Ehrlichman that they were willing to break the law for him. That is not the kind of loyalty I'm talking about. The number one thing I look for is loyalty, loyalty to the mission. You know, putting the mission first. In the Foreign Service, the first thing we were taught is the phrase, needs of the service. That was the answer to every question. So if your boss said, how'd you like to go to Timbuktu for your next tour? Needs of the service. I really want to hire team players who put the mission first. And I am really open and really candid with my staff. I have to trust their loyalty to the organization and to me, because in every job I've ever had, there's been lots of sensitive things, to know that they'll keep confidences. And loyalty also means telling me when I'm wrong, telling me that's stupid, Ron. Don't do that. You know, it's going to blow up. This is why. So, my number two at the Cleveland Foundation, Bob Eckert, I love dearly. He's like my, you know, really I view him as my business partner. I don't think there's like a week that's gone by in 11 years where he hasn't argued with me respectfully, because he knows he can at any time say, I think this is wacky, or I wouldn't do that. And that's why I love working with him, because I trust his loyalty to me to save me from myself, to put the organization's needs first, to remind me, well, that might be good for you, but it's not good for the organization. You know, so I think that is the key qualities that I look for, and I think that really helped, you know, my career. So now I would love to hear your questions, and there's nothing sacred, so you can ask any question, even you, Bess, you can ask any question. Well, first off, one thing I would recommend to all of you is if you ever get a chance to work in all three sectors, it's wonderful, because they're each different and they each have skills. I think one thing that's so sad is the nonprofit sector for so long has had leaders that only were in the nonprofit sector. So when I came to the Cleveland Foundation, they'd done phenomenal work for 90 years, but, you know, I would ask questions to my team the first weeks, you know, so what's our brand? You know, how do we go to market? You know, who's our customer? And they'd say, well, we're a nonprofit. We don't have a brand. And I'd say, so when the Red Cross screwed up with their blood collections and they were under a consent decree and the government was threatening to get them out of the blood business, that didn't hurt their brand? You know, so I think that being able to network across sectors has been, you know, really, really important for me. But, in the Foreign Service, you learn to network because your job is you get dumped into a country every 2 years, a different country. So you may go from the Sudan to Japan to, you know, Paraguay. And you're taught, get out on the circuit. You know, visit the university, you know, find out who are the movers and shakers, who have power and influence, talk to them, know what's going on in the country. Your job is to report back to the State Department, you know, everything that's going on wherever country you're serving in. So, you know, that was very good networking experience. And so when then I left the Foreign Service and went into Panasonic, as I mentioned, I went into R&D. Well, at first, I mean, I can tell you, I had 120 PhDs from Princeton who thought, oh man, we got this turkey here. He doesn't know the difference between hardware and software. But I knew, and what I said to them the first week is, you're probably wondering why I'm here. This is what I was told. There isn't one product in this company with a Panasonic label that came out of your efforts. You're not working at Princeton anymore. You're working for a corporate R&D lab. I don't know diddly about computer science. You're going to teach me enough to not sound like an idiot, because I'm going to give speeches at conferences with this chief technology officer from Microsoft and Apple and IBM and AT&T. You got to teach me enough of the business to talk sensibly about it, but I'm going to teach you who you need to go to at the factories in Japan. And don't you want to come home and show your kids in Best Buy, you know, we made this product, daddy developed it or mommy developed it. And so, you know, there, you know, I learned a lot about taking the Foreign Service skills and networking in a company. And I learned a lot about politics, because the Foreign Service is all about politics. You got to understand the politics of a country, and to succeed, the politics of the Foreign Service. You know, every institution, every company has their own politics. I learned a lot about politics. I learned a lot about something else that's really important, which drives me crazy. I learned a lot about protocol. Protocol is so important, and that has helped me in every job I've ever had. You have to know the proper procedures. When I left the Foreign Service and I was running R&D, all right, so you want to connect the Princeton Computer Science Lab to the division in Japan that makes fax machines, because maybe that division will make a cable modem. You know, we were just getting into the era of cable TV. How do you do it in a way you don't tick anyone off? Who do you talk to first? You have to worry, if I go to this guy first, well, the person under him might be, you know, mad at me, or the person over him. I spent a lot of time plotting what's the proper way to do this. In Japanese culture especially, but also here, it's not what you do, it's how you do it. And how you do it is what makes you successful or not. So when I came to the Cleveland Foundation, my staff would, you know, often say, you know, let's go do this, and I'd say, okay, what's your networking process? And they go, what do you mean? I said, don't you think you better tell the mayor about that before you go talk to the head of the economic development department who works for the mayor? Don't you think we should let Senator Voinovich know about this? Don't you think we should let the governor know about this? Don't you think we better talk to the United Way about this? You know, just getting the protocol right really wins you friends and helps you be successful. So, you know, from all of these experiences, and then, you know, I learned marketing. Well, we're marketing. We're trying to get people to leave money to us when they pass away or give us money while they're alive. That is marketing. What's your brand? You know, what's your value add? What's your core competency? What's your unique value add to the community? You know, these are all things that have, you know, I think really helped me be successful and recruit a phenomenal team. And of course, personnel management's the key thing. Knowing how to hire the right people and how to help them grow, and knowing that not everybody has to be great in everything. You know, one person can be phenomenal in one area and terrible in the other areas, but if you have a team put together, you know, then it'll meld, you know. So I hope that answered your question. Yeah, I think it's a really important question, because it's a maybe not well noticed fact, but you know, because the federal government is so fiscally constrained, because they've mismanaged so badly that we have trillions of dollars in debt, nonprofits, the world of philanthropy, is being asked to do things that was never expected of them before. So for example, in the 10 years I've been here, the Cleveland Foundation has given $85 million for economic development in Greater Cleveland. $85 million, right? No community foundation ever funded economic development before. But I think the way I got this job is when David Goldberg asked me in his first question during my interview, why should we even consider you? You've never worked for a foundation, you know, you've worked for the CIA. And I said, you know, I've worked and run multi-billion dollar corporations. If you don't do something about economic development, you're not going to have an art museum to give money to in 30 years. I think I could figure out how to give money. I know I could help you improve the economy here. And he sort of looked a little shocked, and I guess he liked that answer. More and more philanthropy is being asked to do all sorts of things. You may be familiar that in New York, philanthropy has started something called social impact bonds. So they took Rikers Island, which is the youth detention jail, and they said that, okay, if we can design a program that will lower recidivism by half, it'll save the city of New York $100 million. So philanthropy will lend the money to New York to create these programs to end recidivism. And if you see that it saves you $100 million, you'll pay us back. So now philanthropy's talking about, we have massive public infrastructure, you know, bridges, roads, tunnels. We've got 100-year-old sewer systems. You know, New York City constantly has cars dropping into the ground because a 100-year-old, you know, pipe leaked and it eroded the ground and the roads sunk. And we have all these Midwest cities and other East Coast cities that have 100-year-old sewer systems. And the cities, they don't have the money to fix them. So more and more they're saying, you know, well, maybe philanthropy can lend us the money and we'll pay them back. I think, you know, someday you could have philanthropy owning turnpikes and collecting the tolls to pay themselves back for the initial, you know, monies that were needed to build a road or to build a bridge and, you know, toll bridge and whatnot. So philanthropy is changing very rapidly. It's kind of sad because it means that the government sector is not performing the functions that it should. And candidly, you know, to some extent, the corporate sector isn't. Lee Iacocca wrote a book about 5-6 years ago, maybe 10 years ago now, Where Have All the Leaders Gone? And, you know, we used to have a lot of corporate leaders, and we still have a lot of wonderful corporate leaders around here. I can tell you, I had lunch with James Hambricht of Lubrizol today, an amazing leader. But, you know, we used to have leaders that were all sort of local. You know, they grew up here, they knew that they'd be at the bank here their whole career. Now you get a lot of people, you know, banks get bought up and move to North Carolina, and you get people who aren't from here and may not be here very long. It's just not the same as when you had, you know, Cleveland Tomorrow, where all these local CEOs came together to, you know, get the stadiums built and that sort of thing. So, I mean, we still have great leaders, don't get me wrong, but we just don't have the number of companies. You know, Cleveland 30 years ago was the number 3 headquarters for Fortune 500 companies. We only have a few left. So, you know, by default, philanthropy is becoming more at the center, which is why I'm working really closely with the governor and his folks in Jobs Ohio. I'm one of the 3 people on the oversight panel for Jobs Ohio. Just today, I was on a conference call. We get to decide if we want to let go through or veto all the loans and grants that the state's economic development agency is making. You know, 10 years ago, you never would have had the head of a foundation doing that. But we are so intertwined with the chambers of commerce in this area, in the economic development sphere. You know, it really didn't change a lot because we have such a great investment committee and because we put financial controls in place. So instead of, you know, some foundations When the stock market goes up or down, they're stuck. We have a three-year rolling average of 12 quarters. So our spending rate, most foundations give away the income on their corpus. They don't give away the corpus, right? So most foundations give away 5% of what they have in the bank, because in the old days, you could earn safely 5% putting your money into CDs or treasury bonds. So most of them give, 5%. So for us, 5%, 2 years ago, we gave $92 million away. And in addition to what we give away, we persuade other foundations like Ford, Gates, Rockefeller to invest alongside us in projects in Cleveland. So we kind of leverage in maybe another $30 million in terms of our impact. But because we have a three-year rolling average and because we had hedged our investments so well, we have a phenomenal investment committee that has some of the top people in the city on it who aren't on our board, who aren't on our staff, but we have this great investment committee and advisors, Monticello, that we were not affected nearly as much as other foundations. And what we decided was to actually increase our spending rate to 5.25, because we felt when people need you the most is not when you should cut the spigot on your spending, it's when you should increase it. So I think people were very grateful. We were able to do a lot of things for a lot of nonprofits that were in desperate shape. There was one other person who had a hand up. If you don't mind, Chris, I'll. That's a good question. And no one's ever asked me that question. It certainly had a huge impact. So the first thing that I would say, sorry about that, excuse me. First thing I would say is, I have it in here, but I had to cut short by about 4 pages. one thing you gotta always remember is, work-life balance, and you gotta get your priorities straight. I always don't like it when people talk about, you're being successful, am I being successful? Because success has nothing to do with how much money you make or what your titles have been, in my view. I love Thomas Jefferson. He said that he didn't want it listed on his tombstone that he'd been president of the United States. He just wanted it to say he'd been author of the Declaration of Independence and the Virginia Statute of Religious Liberty. And in my first interview, after David Goldberg asked me, why should we even consider you? Tana Carney on my board said, what do you want written on your tombstone? Which no one had asked me either. And I said that I was a good husband and a great father. So what I'm getting at is I could not have done any of the things I've done in my career if my wife hadn't sacrificed her career to stay home with our daughter. It was a terrible burden for her. It was a terrible burden for me. She had it worse, but it's also really rough to be up half the night with an autistic kid who won't sleep and then have to drive, an hour to work in New York City bound traffic and then have enormous responsibilities and, work from, some morning, 7 a.m. till 8:30 at night and then drive home and, help bathe your daughter and put her in bed and all. And it was, I really think, candidly, if I can speak from the heart, I think the only thing amazing about my career is I managed to do it while being a good father to an autistic kid. Because you can't imagine if you haven't been there, it also helped me understand a lot of things. It helped me understand that every person who I worked with had skills, and you just had to figure out what they were good at. So our daughter was amazing. She was reading at like 18 months. She's amazing at calculating numbers and stuff, but she could never live independently. She couldn't walk a block away and buy an ice cream cone for herself, ever. It's pretty humbling when you drive to New York and in traffic and you park behind the company in the spot reserved for the top brass in front of the and you're weeping in your car because some terrible thing happened with your kid you know, she's scratching her face. It looks like someone took an ice pick to her. And now I got to go in and lead a 4-hour management review, you know, or, you know, give some speech to the Chamber of Commerce or something like nothing happened. And, you know, you got to, you know, look in the mirror and make sure no one could see I was crying, you know, because, you know, it was just such stress and tension and whatnot. But, you know, it really helped me because I remember early on when I was president of the sales company, they were telling me, oh, we got to get rid of, you know, this guy. He just stinks at sales, you know, he's just awful. Really sweet guy, everybody loves him, you know, loves the company, does his best, but, you know, he just stinks. So I called him in and I said, you know, people tell me you stink at sales. Do you like sales? And he said, no, I hate sales. I said, just forget about the company. Just talk to me as a person. What do you love? And when he started describing what he loved, I said, you know, it sounds to me like you're really gifted in market research. You shouldn't be in sales. I'm going to put you in charge of market research and see how you do. This guy, within 6 months, was a superstar. Everyone loved him and everyone came to him because he was so brilliant, you know. So, and even today at the Cleveland Foundation, when people complain about people, I try to figure out, and I always say to people, don't tell me what they're bad at, tell me what they're good at. And tell me who's great at what they're bad at so I can pair them and get them to mentor that person in what they're bad at and make them good at it, or at least supplement them enough that as a team we can be incredibly powerful and impactful and valuable. And so I think my daughter has done a lot for my career.